Hello, my name is Stéphane Farou, I'm a French database consultant, and I wish to guide your first steps in Oracle administration in a few videos. I shall base my videos on Oracle Express, an edition of Oracle that is free, but stores up to 4 GB of user data, uses up to 1 GB of memory, and is supposed to use a single processor, which is enough for many applications. It can be downloaded from this URL. Otherwise, it's the same Oracle as all the other editions, and it is presented by Oracle as a starter database for database administrators. Most of the things I will show you are valid with any Oracle edition. If you haven't watched yet my video about the architecture of Oracle, which is elsewhere on this site, you may find useful to do it before you watch this video. If you are interested by Oracle Express, it's very likely that either you simply want to learn Oracle, or you are already familiar with Oracle and wish to capitalize on your knowledge for a new project, in which case you would probably not watch this video, or you have a new project that you want to start on the cheap, but which you plan to upgrade to the paying Standard Edition or Enterprise Edition one day. The problem is that if the tools that are provided with Oracle Express make it easy to use for a developer, they don't really guide you into administering Oracle the way the other editions are administered. I shall therefore try to focus, past the installation stage, on concepts that are common to all editions of Oracle, and, even if you are using Oracle Express, I'll try to take you closer to the real world of Oracle administration. When you install Oracle Express on Windows, it's basically a question of clicking Next all along. You are asked three things, first to accept the license, then where on your disk you wish to install the Oracle software and your database files, and finally, the password you want to give to the sys and system accounts, two key accounts in an Oracle database. The Oracle software and the initial database that is created use about 1.2 GB of storage, and you will find installed on your machine about 2,400 new files in 140 directories. Out of this, only 100 MB are initially allocated for user data. Beware that even if you are limited by the license to 4 GB of user data, the database doesn't contain only user data. The data dictionary uses much storage, and if you want to use Apex to develop your applications, they will be stored in the database too. Most importantly, you will need to back up your database, and the copy will be probably stored at least temporarily on disk. You must therefore make sure that you have at least 10 or 15 GB available if you want to be in the comfort zone. If you install Oracle Express on Linux, and I have done it on Ubuntu and OpenSUSE, there may be some minor differences on other Linuxes, then you first install a package, and the location that is asked during the Windows installation is forced as /usr/lib/oracle. For having tried it, creating a link to elsewhere prior to installing the package is a bad idea, because it makes, in the next stage, the restoration of the template database fail. If they don't already exist, an Oracle account and a DBA group will also be created, and the home directory of the Oracle account will be set to /usr/lib/oracle/xe. A shell script called oracle-xe will be also created under /etc/init.d. You will then need to connect as root and run this shell script with a configure parameter. This script will prompt you for four things: the HTTP port for the web-based administration toy, the TCP port for connecting to the database from other machines, the common password for users sys and system, and whether you want the database to be started when your server boots, which you usually want. Interestingly, the only common question with the Windows install is the password. For Windows, the default values of 8080, 1521 and Y are used. Disabling automatic service start is easy, and I'm going to show you shortly where the port values are used. This operation creates a configuration file called oracle-xe that you will find, depending on your Linux, either under /etc/sysconfig or /etc/default. You are unsupposed to modify it by hand, but if you want to change it, you must delete it before running the script that creates it. Another file that will be created is called /etc/oratab. The installation script we created with a line that starts by XE, followed by a colon, a longish path, another colon, and N. If you want to rerun the configuration script, you should remove this line from the oratab file. This brings me to a first discrepancy between Oracle Express and the other editions. This file is the standard Unix way to tell Oracle that you want one particular database instance to be started when the machine boots. There is one line per database with three fields separated by colons. The first one is the name of the instance, the second one is what is called the Oracle Home and tells where the Oracle binaries are located. It allows having several different versions of Oracle running simultaneously on the same machine. The third field must normally set to Y if you want your database to be started at boot time. Oracle Express is the only edition that doesn't use this file for this purpose. You can safely let N. On Windows, you will notice after the installation two services running. One is called Oracle XE TNS Listener, and it has two functions. It listens on one port, 1521 by default, for incoming connections to the database, and it also doubles as a lightweight HTTP server that listens on port 8080 for the administration interface and Apex applications. The other service is Oracle Service XE that accesses the data in memory, in the SGA, and the data files. On Linux, the picture is a bit different. The listener is a process called TNS-LSNR, but instead of a single service for the database, you have a large number of specialized processes. In Windows, their roles is played by threads in the service, of which I am only showing a few, and each connection will usually create a new server process. You can easily check a few things in a console. In Linux, you should have a few variables set in your environment. The most important one is called Oracle Home, and this should be the second field in the oratab file. You should also include $oracle_home/bin in your path and set oracle_sid to XE. This part of Oracle Home is sometimes known in Oracle as Oracle Base, and it is the equivalent of the installation directory that you provide in the Windows installation. Be careful though, because the definition of Oracle Base isn't consistent across Oracle versions. Let's say that this will be my definition of Oracle Base. You can check the listener status by typing lsnrctl-stat. It will first list you information about the version, current settings, and the names of the file that stores the parameters for the listener. You should take a look at it, as well as the log file. But then comes the most interesting. You have the list of communication types that the listener can handle. IPC refers to inter-process communications. That's usually what is used when you access the database from the server itself. The next line is for TCP connections, and the information that is displayed is read from the parameter file. The last line is for the HTTP connection, and this is not read from the parameter file. In fact, the port is stored inside the database itself, where you can change it if it conflicts with something else. The way it works is that you start the listener first. When instance XE is started, any instance in fact, it looks for a listener and registers itself with this listener. That way, the listener knows that the database instance is ready to accept connections. The listener gets the HTTP port in the process. And if you check the listener status, you can verify that the database instance has registered. You find other services that are registered, but this is the important one. I'd like now to guide you in the jungle of the 140 directories and point to you the most important places. First, below what I have called Oracle Base, you'll find App and Aerodata. I keep Aerodata for later. Under App, you find Oracle, Admin, and XE. That is in fact the name or Oracle SID of your database instance. If you were running several instances on the same machine, you would have one directory per instance. Below this, you have a few directories, most of which have a name that ends in dump, and usually fill up with .trc files, trace files that may or may not relate to an interesting problem. What is really important here is in bdump the file called alert_xe.log. Of course, once again, xe is the Oracle SID and the name will be different for another instance. This file records every change to the structure of the database, as well as errors, which sometimes point to a .trc file nearby. This is the file to watch when you want to check that everything is fine or after a problem. Many DBAs write scripts that scan this file for lines that contain error-, which indicates an error. You may also want to rotate this log file from time to time, as well as remove old .trc files. As an Oracle DBA, it's usually very useful to have scripting skills. Note that this hierarchy changes after Oracle 10. If you have to deal with Oracle 11, you will find the alert file under diag, RDBMS, the database name and the instance name, several different instances, that is sets of processes serving a memory area, can share a single database that is a set of files. This kind of configuration can be met with very large databases. In most cases, you have one instance per database, and the name of the database is equal to the name of the instance. Another set of directories below, and the alert file isn't under alert, that would be too easy, but under trace. But let's return to Oracle Express. At the same level as admin, you have a doc directory that contains HTML documentation. If I'd thought that it's amazingly good for learning Oracle administration, you wouldn't be watching this video. You also have flash recovery area, and this one is really important. You have one XE directory, once again it's one directory per instance, and below you have online log that contains two read log files, that is, the journal of transactions that is used to restore the database to inconsistent state if the machine crashes. Oracle writes them one after the other in a circular fashion, and you don't have to worry about their growing out of control. Flash recovery area is also very important because that's the place where the backup of your files will go when you use the backup utility that is provided with the database. I'll tell more about the topic in another video. Finally, still at the same level, you find a product directory, and that's where the Oracle distribution really goes, with one subdirectory per version of the software, and a server subdirectory, because today the database server proper is just one offer in the Oracle product range. This entire path, Oracle Base, App, Oracle, Product, Version Number, Server, is what is known as Oracle Home. You find it in OraTab on Unix, if you remember, and it's defined in the registry on Windows. Many directories are there. I just want right now to point at two of them. Bin contains all the Oracle programs, the database program itself, but also the SQL Plus client, for instance, and all utilities. You must make sure that it's in your execution path. And DBS contains a file named spfile nameoftheinstance.ora that contains the configuration parameters of your database instance. It's a binary file, I'll tell you more about it later. After wrap, it's much simpler on the Ora data side. One directory per instance, and there you have first the control file, and then the various data files that make up your database. The data dictionary and other internal data in system and sysaux, a work area in temp when you have, for instance, to perform massive sorts that cannot fit in memory, undo that stores what is required to roll back transactions, and finally users that contains user data. File names are in lowercase on Linux. Here is the layout, and we'll see more about administration proper later. Stay tuned.